the last couple of videos we've seen the path lifting property of covering spaces. In other words, if you have a space X and some covering space Y, and you have a path, maybe I'll just draw it as a loop, it can be any path, gamma in X, let's say based little x, then for each Y in P inverse of X, so each pre-image of X, there exists a unique path gamma tilde starting at Y, lifting gamma. So the projection of gamma tilde is gamma. Now, if I start with a loop gamma downstairs, there's no guarantee the path upstairs has to be a loop, right? We saw examples, for example, this covering space of the circle. It was a 2-to-1 map. If you start off at this point here, that lives over this point downstairs, and you follow along the lift of the path, you end up over here. So just because you have a loop downstairs doesn't mean that the lifted path also has to be a loop. And this allows us to define this notion of monodromy. So the monodromy, let me remind you, I gave you a kind of intuitive definition of it earlier. So given a loop gamma in X based at little x, we're going to define the monodromy around gamma to be sigma gamma. This is a permutation, so define sigma gamma to be the permutation of P inverse X, defined by saying sigma gamma of Y is gamma tilde of 1, where gamma tilde is the unique lift of gamma starting at Y. Right, that's what this picture means. You start at some point Y, you follow the unique lift for time 1, you come to some other point that lives over the same point downstairs. That's the result of applying your monodromy. So we get a permutation, which I'm calling sigma gamma, of the set P inverse X. Now, that's well defined. But what is not clear is, if I give you two different loops that happen to be in the same based homotopy class, do they give you the same permutation? The answer is yes, of course they will, but we need to prove it. So claim, if gamma 1 is based homotopic to gamma 2, then sigma gamma 1, the permutation, equals sigma gamma 2. So to prove this, I'm going to need another lifting property called the homotopy lifting property of covering spaces. So I'm going to prove the homotopy lifting property, and then it'll be up to you to figure out why that implies this claim. So the homotopy lifting lemma suppose P is a covering map. And gamma S is a homotopy which is, it's going to be a homotopy rel endpoints. Remember, this means they all start and end at the same point. So gamma S0 and gamma S1 are independent of S. So the picture is you've got these 2 points, you've got a bunch of paths between them that form a one parameter family. Well, the claim is then there exists for each lift gamma tilde zero of gamma zero, a lifted homotopy. Gamma tilde S of gamma tilde 0. So lifted here means if I project gamma tilde S, I get gamma S. And importantly, this is a lifted homotopy rel endpoints. The endpoints don't kind of wiggle around. Okay, how are we going to prove this? Let H be the homotopy in X. So I've been writing the homotopy as like gamma S. I want to think of all those together as a map from the square into X. So the continuous map in X such that HST equals gamma ST. Right, remember, you can think of a homotopy as a map from the square or as a one parameter family of paths. Right. So I claim what we can do is we can subdivide the square, the square into rectangles etc., which I'm going to label rij. Maybe I is the coordinate in that direction, j is a coordinate in that direction, so this would be R21, R32, R31, R41, R12, etc. Such that H of Rij is contained in Uij for some elementary neighborhood. Uij. Why is this true? I'll leave you to think about that. If you can't think off the top of your head why it's true, go back and have a look at the proof of path lifting. That might give you a hint. So the strategy to construct the lift, strategy to find the lifted homotopy, which again I'm going to think of as a map from the square into Y, is to pick local inverses Qij defined on Uij for each of these elementary neighborhoods for the covering map, local inverses for the covering map, and set H tilde restricted to Rij to be equal to Qij composed with H. So So certainly if I do that, if we do that, then when I project this H tilde homotopy, I get P composed QIJ composed H, and QIJ is a local inverse for P, so this is the identity, and I just get H. So by construction, if I can do this, then H tilde is a lift of the homotopy H. What is not clear is that I can pick local inverses QIJ in such a way that H tilde is continuous, right? I'm trying to basically define a continuous map. First here, then here, then here, then here. And you know, it needs to be continuous. So it needs to agree on the edges between these rectangles. I may well make it continuous on the interior of a square, but I need to make it agree on the overlaps. So what we're going to do is inductively, over these I and J's, pick QIJ in such a way as to maintain continuity. So here is a square I made earlier, and I've just assumed there's only four subsquares just for simplicity to make our life easier. So the first place I'm going to construct the QIJs is here and here. Then I'm going to construct this one, and then finally this one. So how am I going to work? Well, I'm going to start on this edge here. Because that's a path, right? That's just an interval on the edge of the square. And I know already how to lift paths. So, in fact, I don't even have to lift, because I'm given, if you look back at the statement of the lemma, I'm given a lift gamma tilde 0 of gamma 0 along that edge. And that actually tells me which Q's to use. So what is Q11? Well, Q11, which goes from U11 to Y, is the unique local inverse with Q11 of this point, so I guess that's gamma 0 at 0 equal to gamma tilde 0 at 0. All right, so there's only one local inverse I can pick over this open set, which sends the base point of the loop to the base point of the lifted path, the start of the initial point of the lifted path. Similarly, Q12 is uniquely determined by the condition that gamma 0 of whatever time this is, maybe you call it, if this coordinate is the S coordinate and this is the T coordinate, this is sort of T1. Is equal to gamma tilde 0 of T1. And you could continue, you add more squares upwards. So what we need to check is that actually this makes sense along this edge, right? We need to check that this gives us a continuous map along this overlap between these two rectangles. So it certainly works on this edge because gamma 0 tilde is continuous by assumption. So why does it continue to be continuous along this whole blue edge? Well, this blue edge is a path, the blue edge gives a path in Y. How? Well, if I restrict Q11 to H of ST1, right? So T1 is the height of this blue edge. As S varies, I get a path, right, at H of ST1 in X, and now I'm composing that with Q11. And it gives another path, which is Q12, because that blue edge is also on the bottom of this rectangle. And both of these paths project down to the same path. They both project down to HST1 under the projection map, the covering map P, because that's an inverse for Q11 and for Q12. So they're both lifts of this path in X. So it doesn't just give one path. Maybe I'll say it gives two paths. Both lifts of HST1. And moreover, at this point here they agree, because they agree with gamma 0 tilde at T1. So Q11 of H0 T1 equals gamma tilde 0 of T1. That equals Q12 of H0 T1. So you have two different lifts of the same path that agree at the initial point. Well, they have to be the same. So that tells us Q11 of HS T1 equals Q12 of HS T1 by the uniqueness of path lifting, which we proved in the previous video. Okay, so actually we have a continuous map Q11 compose H defined down here on R11, and we also have a continuous map on R12, and they agree on the overlap, therefore they give us a continuous map on this whole vertical strip. And now I claim we're actually done, because we can do this exactly the same trick now, starting with this guy. Right, so this is now, if this is S1, this is gamma S1 tilde. We've constructed this lift, and we can do exactly the same thing and extend over the next vertical strip, etc., until we've covered the whole square. So that's how we construct a continuous lift. So let me write it down, proceeding inductively in I, we construct a continuous H tilde over the whole square. Okay, let's just go back up and check. Are we done yet? We had to find a lifted homotopy, and I also really want this to be a homotopy rel endpoints. What does that mean? In terms of these pictures, these squares, that means the homotopy restricted to this bottom edge has to be constant, and the homotopy restricted to this top edge has to be constant. So let's prove this. So moreover, H tilde S0 is constant because it is a lift of HS0 which is constant, right? So if you remember, we started out with a homotopy rel endpoint, so it was constant at this end, constant at this end. So downstairs, the path HS0 is constant, therefore the lift has to be constant because it is a lift of the constant map, and lifts are unique. So since lifts are unique, and since the constant lift is a lift of the constant path, this implies that H tilde S0 is constant itself. Similarly for HS1. Okay, so that proves that it's a homotopy rel endpoints. Okay, so that is homotopy lifting. For now, that's all the lifting we're going to need. There's another more general lifting theorem we'll see later, but this is all we need for now. And that enables us to see, I claim, that the monodromy around a loop is independent of the homotopy class of that loop, which is going to be incredibly useful, because in the next video we're going to use that observation to prove that the fundamental group of the circle is the integers, which is something we've been working towards for a very long time.